Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How are you all doing? Alhamdulillah. Nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulihi al-kareem. Amma ba'd fa'a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri. Wahlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Allahumma ihdi qalbi wa saddid lisani. Waslul sakhimata qalbi. Juz number 24.
Faman azlamu mimman kadhaba 'ala Allahi wa kadhaba bis-sidqi idh ja'a. Alaysa fi jahannama mathwan lil kafirin. وَالَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصِّدْقِ وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ أُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ عِندَ رَبِّهِمْ ذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ الْمُحْسِنِينَ ليكفر الله عنهم أسوأ الذي عملوا ويجزيهم أجرهم بأحسن الذي كانوا يعملون أليس الله بكاف عبده ويخوفونك بالذين من دونه وَمَن يُضْلِلِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ هَادٍ وَمَن يَهْدِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ مُضِلٍّ أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِعَزِيزٍ ذِي انْتِقَامٍ
فَمَن أَظْلَمُ مِمَّن كَذَبَ عَلَى اللَّهِ وكذب بالصدق إذ جاءه أليس في جهنم مثوى للكافرين والذي جاء بالصدق وصدق به أولئك هم المتقون. So who is more unjust than one who lies about Allah and denies the truth when it has come to him? Is there not in hell a residence for the disbelievers? Aren't they deserving of it? And the one who has brought the truth, and they who believed in it, those are the righteous. Those are the ones who truly fear Allah. Those are the ones who will be saved from the punishment. We see that in this world, majority of the people, they entertain incorrect thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these thoughts, they turn into beliefs. And we see that majority of the people, what they believe about Allah is based on pure falsehood and mere assumptions. We see that every ideology about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is based on untruth, what is it? It is a lie. It is falsehood. So it is basically lying about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning having any thought, any faith, any belief about Allah that contradicts reality. Thinking of Him what He is not. Thinking about Allah what He is not. Then this is lying about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see that in every era there have been people who have had false beliefs about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shirk is part of this. Kufr is part of this. Atheism is also part of this. And this has been from the beginning. It's just that these beliefs have transformed over time. But we see that many people in every era, they have entertained incorrect beliefs, incorrect thoughts, false beliefs about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the first priority of a person should be to know his Lord, to recognize his Lord. That who is my Allah? Who is the one who made me? Who sent me here? Who is it that I worship? This is why Allah says in the Quran that فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّهُ. You should have knowledge that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah. So this is of those matters that we must learn about. That we should not remain in any confusion about this. That who is Allah? What are His attributes? And when a person, if he has not come to know about who Allah really is, then what good was his life? What is the outcome of his life? That if he has spent years and years in this world, but he has not managed to recognize his Creator, his Maker, his Master, then what use was his life? What good was his life? What did his life bring him? So we see that this is pure ignorance and pure loss if a person does not come to know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it should be our priority to learn about who Allah is. And we see that Allah has not left people to themselves that figure out who your Creator is, figure out yourself why you are here, who sent you here. No, Allah sent prophets in every era to guide mankind. And then after the prophets ended, meaning Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam being the last messenger, after him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved his teachings. He preserved the Qur'an. And after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see that there have been numerous people in every era to spread the authentic teachings of the Qur'an and Sunnah. So when the truth comes to people, whether it was through the prophets or it came after the prophets, we see that people have divided into two groups. One is a group of those who believe in the prophets of Allah, who believe in Allah the way they should believe in. And these people, Allah says, they are muttaqoon. The one who brought the truth and the one who believed in it. Who are they? The muttaqoon. They are the ones who truly fear Allah. They are the righteous. They will be saved from punishment. And the other group of those who have rejected the truth, who have rejected correct belief in Allah, then who are they? Allah says, أَلَيْسَ فِي جَهَنَّمَ مَثْوًا لِلْكَافِرِينَ. Then such people, do they not deserve to be in hell? Is that not the abode that they deserve? Is that what they are not worthy of? Because if they have not recognized Allah, then what have they come to know? If they have not worshipped Allah, then what have they done in their lives, with their lives? So for us, our number one priority in life should be to know Allah, to worship Him, to increase in our love, in our fear, in our adoration of Allah Azza wa Jal. Otherwise, we have not fulfilled the purpose of our existence. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. Those who do believe in Allah, الَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصِّدْقِ وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ. Those people, Allah says, they will be saved. And where will they be? They will be in Jannah. They will have whatever they desire with their Lord. Because they recognize their Lord in the world, in this life. So in the hereafter, what will they get? Whatever they wish. That is the reward of the muhsineen, of those who do good. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you wish that Allah and His Messenger should love you, if you wish that Allah should love you, His Messenger should love you, then guard three characteristics. Firstly, truthful speech. Be truthful. Be truthful, meaning listen to truth, speak to the truth, believe in the truth, live by the truth. Secondly, return trusts. Meaning if an amanah has been given to you, then look after it properly. And thirdly, be a good neighbor. Be a good neighbor. These are three matters, three qualities that make a person beloved to Allah, and they also make him beloved to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And number one is adhering to truth. لِيُكَفِّرَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ أَسْوَأَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا. That Allah may remove from them the worst of what they did. Meaning, the righteous, those who do believe in the truth, who affirm the truth, who live by it, then after all they're human beings. And the worst sins that they have committed, what does Allah say? Allah will remove those sins from them. What a great good news this is. The worst sins, look at this, the worst of what they have done. Allah will clean their records and He will reward them their due for the best of what they used to do. So their worst sins will be finished, eliminated. Then what do you think about the little sins? They too will be eliminated. And their ajr will be according to the best deeds that they used to perform. The Prophet ﷺ said that a believer will be brought to his Lord, the Exalted and Glorious, on the Day of Resurrection. And Allah will place upon him his side. And Allah will make him confess his faults and say, do you recognize your faults? And that believer will say, my Lord, I do recognize them. Meaning he will admit. Why? Because he was truthful. He lived by the truth in this world, and on the Day of Judgment, when he will be asked about his sins, he will be truthful over there also. So Allah will say, I concealed them for you in the world, and today I forgive them. And he will then be given the book containing the accounts of his deeds, and he will see that his sins are erased, and he will be given his reward according to the best of his deeds. This is true success. But this comes from what? From holding on to the truth, from believing in the truth and holding on to it. Because many times it happens that we agree with the truth. We agree with what Allah has revealed, with what He has commanded. But what happens in our practical life? What happens over there? We fall short in obeying Allah. So this reward is for those who, الَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصِّدْقِ وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ. He confirms the truthfulness of the words of Allah by living them, by practicing them, by bringing them in his life. Allah says, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِكَافٍ عَبْدَهُ. Is Allah not sufficient for his servant? Yes, he is. Very much so. Why? Because he is the owner of all the treasures. He is the one in whose hand is everything. But sadly, instead of looking up to Allah, we look at people for help and support. That when we are in any weakness, in any difficulty, we turn towards people, looking at them, that who is it that will help me today? Who is it that will support me today? Every Prophet of Allah, what was his statement? حَسْبِ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Allah is enough for me, and sufficient is He as a trustee. And the Prophets of Allah remembered Allah at the time of every need. So, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِكَافٍ عَبْدًا. And yet, they threaten you with those other than Him. Meaning they threaten you with others, with people, with idols, or with false gods. And for us, what is the greatest fear? People. It's amazing how young girls even, if they want to pray, or young boy even, if he wants to pray, they're trying to take their deen seriously. Who frightens them? It's their own families that frighten them. Frighten them of who? Of other people. That what are others going to say? If you put this hijab on, people are going to look at you. People are going to stare at you. People are not going to be happy. You're going to be the only person. يُخَوِّفُونَكْ. They try to frighten you with those other than Him. But the fact is that the one who really believes in Allah, he truly fears Allah also. And whoever Allah leaves astray, for him there is no guide. And whoever Allah guides, for him there is no one to mislead. No one can misguide him. Even if he is all alone, even if he is in the midst of people who reject Allah, still Allah will keep him guided. So isn't it necessary that we keep asking Allah for guidance? Is not Allah exalted in might and owner of retribution? And if you ask them, who created the heavens and the earth? They will surely say, Allah. Then, have you considered what you invoke besides Allah? If Allah intended me harm, are they removers of any difficulty? Meaning if Allah was to inflict harm on me, can those besides Allah remove that harm from me? No way. If He intended me mercy, are they withholders of His mercy? Because you see, sometimes a person is in difficulty and the whole world is trying to help him. The whole world is trying to rescue him. But that pain, that illness cannot be taken away unless Allah takes that difficulty away from a person. Likewise, a person is receiving some mercy from Allah, something valuable, something beneficial, and others are not happy. They're not happy at all. Can that be removed? No way. So we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He teaches us, قُلْ حَسْبِ اللَّهِ. Trust upon Allah and say, sufficient for me is Allah. In every worry, in every difficulty, in every trial, I do not need to go to any deity, any غير Allah. Allah is enough for me. My Lord is enough for me. Upon Him alone rely. The wise reliers. Meaning those who truly rely, who is it that they rely upon? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they're the ones who are successful. Because relying upon other than Allah, that is not reliance. Relying upon other than Allah, is it reliance? No way. Like for example, if a person is falling and he tries to hold on to a spider's web, is that reliance? Would you call that reliance? Would you call that strategy? No way. What is it? It's a pathetic attempt. It's useless. It's not going to get a person anywhere. A person is making a fool of himself. Likewise, relying upon anyone other than Allah, it is as if a person is holding on to, is reaching out for a cobweb when he is falling. So, حَسْبِيَ Allah, upon Him, عَلَيْهِ يَتَوَكَّلُ الْمُتَوَكِّلُونَ, upon Him should those who rely upon. Say, O my people, work according to your position, for indeed I am also working, and you are going to know, to whom will come a torment, disgracing him, and on whom will descend an enduring punishment. Indeed, we sent down to you the book for the people in truth. This Qur'an is for who? For all of mankind. So the question is that how many people are we taking this Qur'an to? You know, this is something that we really need to take seriously. Allah says that inna anzalna alayka al-kitaba lin-nas, for all people. So how many people am I taking this Qur'an to? So whoever is guided, it is for the benefit of his soul. And whoever goes astray, only goes astray to its detriment. And you are not a manager over them. Meaning if you call somebody to the Qur'an and they benefit, good for them. But if they don't, they're not going to harm you. So why not at least try and call people to the book of Allah? The question is, how is it that we can take the Qur'an to other people? How is it that we can tell them about what is in the Qur'an? How can we do that? I'm asking you, it's not a rhetorical question. So I really need answers from you. How is it that we can take the Qur'an to people so that they get to know what Allah has revealed? Okay, so first of all, at least learn ourselves. This is the first step, because if we haven't known what is in the Qur'an, what can we tell other people about the Qur'an? You know, for example, we say to others that, oh, Qur'an is the book of Allah, it's the most truthful book. And when the people ask us questions about the Qur'an, we have no idea how to answer them. Or we say that we believe in the book of Allah, and when we're asked, okay, what does it say? I don't know. So the first step is that we must come to know about what is in the Qur'an. This should be the priority of every Muslim man and every Muslim woman. This should be our priority. I mean, think about it. School, is it not necessary? It is, right? How many children who say, I don't want to go to college, I don't want to go to university, and what do the parents say? No way. You don't have a choice. You have to go. Likewise, high school even. So many children, they're like, I don't want to go. But what happens? The parents, they don't give them a choice. So likewise, Qur'an is something that we should not give ourselves a choice about. Should I learn about it or should I not learn about it? No, we must learn about it. Okay, now what's the next step? How can we practically tell other people about what is in the Qur'an? Yes, that when somebody's going through a particular issue and then you tell them about what is in the Qur'an, you relate what they're going through in their lives with the Qur'an, and then what happens? They find guidance from the book of Allah. Okay, so bringing the Qur'an in our conversations, that is one way. What's another way? Okay, our actions, our behaviors, what else? How else can we tell people about what is in the Qur'an? How about giving them a Qur'an? So this Ramadan, alhamdulillah, there are many organizations who are preparing, for example, new Muslim gift boxes, or for instance, Qur'an for the purpose of da'wah. And it doesn't really cost much, $5, $10 maximum. So see where you can contribute, inshallah. Even if one person is guided through you, that is better for you than 100 red camels, it's better for you. Likewise, alhamdulillah, this class also is an attempt to get to know about what is in the Qur'an. So we come ourselves, how about telling somebody else also, inshallah? Because alhamdulillah, we're reaching the end, so make sure that you call at least one more person. Maybe your daughter, your cousin, your niece, your sister, whoever it is, call them. Alhamdulillah, now schools are off. Many mothers are at home. And alhamdulillah, over here at Aliza, we also have a children's program running parallel to this class to make it easier for women, because generally women find it difficult to go to classes because of children. We cannot even go and listen to a khutbah in peace. So alhamdulillah, here, inshallah, the kids can also enjoy, and we can also get to study Qur'an in peace, inshallah. So make sure you take this message forward. Likewise, we share things on our public profiles and all of that online, on social media, sharing something from the Qur'an also. Because Allah says that inna anzalna alayka al-kitaba lin-nasi bil-haq. It is for the people. So it would be unfair if we keep this treasure to ourselves. This would be injustice. Allah takes the souls at the time of their death, and those that do not die, He takes during their sleep. Meaning in sleep, our soul also departs partially. It leaves the body partially. This is why sleep is a sister of death. It's very similar to death. Because when a person is dead, does he talk? Does he listen? No. Can he eat and drink and walk? No. And likewise, a person who is asleep is the same way. Can they walk? Sometimes people sleepwalk, but they cannot recall what they were saying, where they were going. So it's like a dead person basically. Now this is a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows to us daily. He puts us to sleep and He wakes us up. So sleep should remind us of death. And the du'as that the Prophet ﷺ taught us to say before we fall asleep, they also remind us of death. What is the du'a that we say before we sleep? Allahumma bismika amutu wa ahya. Or bismika Allahumma amutu wa ahya. In your name I die and in your name I shall rise. Likewise, we learn the Prophet ﷺ would say, بِسْمِكَ رَبِّي وَضَعْتُ جَنْبِي وَبِكَ أَرْفَعُهُ إِنْ أَمْسَكْتَ نَفْسِي فَارْحَمْهَا. إِنْ أَمْسَكْتَ نَفْسِي. If you retain, if you keep my soul, meaning you don't send me back, then فَارْحَمْهَا, show mercy to it. وَإِنْ أَرْسَلْتَهَا فَاحْفَظْهَا بِمَا تَحْفَظُ بِهِ عِبَادَكَ الصَّالِحِينَ. You see, death is something that we cannot control. Sleep, is that something we can control? No. Where is it that we fall asleep sometimes? In the most awkward positions, in the most awkward places. Daily we experience death. Sleep is something that reminds us that death is real. It is coming. The Prophet ﷺ, when he would wake up in the morning, he would say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi an-nushur. All praise to Allah who gave us life after He caused us death. Also we learned the Prophet ﷺ would say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi afani fi jasadi wa radda alayya ruhi wa adhina li bi dhikri. That all praise to Allah who kept my body in a good condition and He returned my soul to me and allowed me to remember Him. So these are all the du'as that we can say before sleeping and also on waking up. And alhamdulillah, the Al-Huda app, which is free for Apple, Android, you can search for it inshallah. In that is also a section of du'as before sleeping and du'as on waking up. So make sure you benefit from this treasure. Because it's a way of remembering Allah before we sleep and after we wake up. Because generally what happens, we are in bed, lying in bed, waiting to fall asleep. So that's the best time to remember Allah. Then He keeps those for which He has decreed death and releases the others for a specified term. Indeed in that are signs for people who give thought. Indeed in that are signs for people who give thought. So reflect on sleep. That even our sleep we want to make ibadah. And when we wake up, we want to make use of the time that we are awake in. أَمِتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ شُفَعَاءَ. Or have they taken other than Allah as intercessors? Say, even though they do not possess power over anything, nor do they reason. Say, to Allah belongs the right to allow intercession entirely. To Him belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth. Then to Him you will be returned. And when Allah is mentioned alone, the hearts of those who do not believe in the hereafter shrink with aversion. But when those worshipped other than Him are mentioned, immediately they rejoice. This is the state of the mushrikeen and also many people who claim to be Muslim. That when only Quran is mentioned, only Allah is mentioned, they say, oh, this is boring. But when the stories, false stories of certain individuals are mentioned, made up stories, then they find it very amusing, they find it very attractive, and that is what they enjoy. But only when Quran is mentioned, they're not interested. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ فَاطِرَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Say, O Allah, Creator of the heavens and the earth, Knower of the unseen and the witnessed, You will judge between Your servants concerning that over which they used to differ. You see, there's so many issues, so many differences in life to which there seems to be no solution. Like for example, family issues. Now what should a person do? Get caught up in these problems? No. Some things, yes, you can resolve, but other things, you cannot solve them. So what should you do? Rely upon Allah and ask Him for guidance. And if those who did wrong had all that is in the earth entirely and the like of it with it, they would attempt to ransom themselves thereby from the worst of the punishment on the day of resurrection. And there will appear to them from Allah that which they had not taken into account. وَبَدَى لَهُمْ سَيِّئَاتُ مَا كَسَبُوا. And there will appear to them the evils they had earned, and they will be enveloped by what they used to ridicule. This is so frightening. Imagine all of a person's sins are displayed before him. The sins that he had forgotten, that he didn't even consider to be sin, all will appear. And a person will be surrounded, enveloped by what he used to ridicule, what he used to mock at. Because today, we have freedom. When we wake up from sleep, we think, you know, we have the freedom to do whatever we please. And so we misuse the freedom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And because of that, we mock at others, we make fun of other people, we ridicule the truth, we look down on the Qur'an, we don't give attention to the dhikr of Allah. These are all big mistakes which will haunt a person on the Day of Judgment. Surround a person, not let him get away. Because this is reality. You see, in this life what happens? We do certain things and we completely overlook them. We say certain things and we don't even think about them. And when somebody reminds us of our mistakes, we say, quiet, quiet, quiet. Don't say it. Don't talk about it. Sometimes children remind us. Or sometimes our friends remind us. Has it ever happened that people remind you of the things that you used to do while you were a child? Or maybe 10 years ago, the silly things that you did? Do we like to hear those stories? No way. Not at all. So imagine on the Day of Judgment, a person's sins will be displayed before him. So remember, this freedom that we have right now is for a very, very limited amount of time. So let's not misuse it. Let's use it in obedience to Allah. And when adversity touches man, any kind of adversity, poverty, illness, some worry, what does he do? He calls upon us. Then when we bestow on him a favor from us, he says, I have only been given it because of my knowledge. Meaning whatever he has, he begins to think it was because of his own effort. He forgets Allah's gift and thinks of himself. He gives credit to himself. He gives credit to his own efforts. He gives credit to people, to the things in this world, for the information that he found, for the knowledge that he had, and he forgets to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ. I have this job because of my degree. Well, we know people who have big degrees, but they don't have good jobs. A person may be very knowledgeable in their field, very knowledgeable, but what job do they have? What rank do they have? Hardly anything. So the fact is that whatever blessings we enjoy, when any hardship is turned into ease, when any problem is taken away, remember, this is by Allah's mercy, not just because of our efforts. Our efforts, in fact, are a part of Allah's mercy. Part of Allah's mercy on us. Because how many people there are for whom literally their success is in front of them. All they need to do is just put in a little bit of effort. But do they? No, they don't. Clever minds, intelligent people, but they're not interested in studying. They're not interested in working. They're not interested in pursuing something big in life. They don't want to do it. Right? So the fact that we got the right information, we got the right kind of people, we got the right opportunities, and then we could actually benefit from them, all of this is Allah's gift upon us. Allah says, rather, it is a trial, but most of them do not know. Most of them do not know that this was a trial that Allah had put them in. Those before them had already said similar words, but they were not availed by what they used to earn. What happens when a person receives something good in this life? He begins to think, oh, it was because of me, my effort, I'm the best. Right? I'm so hardworking, I'm so smart, I'm so intelligent. Well, people before said bigger words. But what happened? Did their education, did their degrees, did their career, did their money save them from death? No. Did their power save them from problems in this life? No way. What happened? فَأَصَابَهُمْ سَيِّئَاتُ مَا كَسَبُوا. The evil consequences of what they earned struck them. And those who have wronged of these people will be afflicted by the evil consequences of what they earned. And they will not cause failure.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How are you all doing?
Alhamdulillah.
نحمده ونصلي